This is the EWN Radio Network. Welcome to Thriving Entrepreneur with your host, Steve Kidd, third-generation minister and business coach. Join Steve and his guests to get answers to your questions and help break through to the next level in your business.
This is Steve. Welcome to Thriving Entrepreneur. Thank you so much for being here with us today. Today, we're going to give you some insight into some of the things that, you know, we don't always talk about as entrepreneurs. We want you to understand that your greatest success is going to come a minute, a week, a day, a month, maybe even a couple of years after some of your greatest mistakes. You see, the thing about it is mistakes are normal. Every one of us makes it. And often, I'm sorry to say, but it's often the case that we get to a place as adults where we don't allow ourselves grace. I'm not talking about anything that's some kind of spiritual concept. I'm simply talking about applying, the understanding that we would give to our children. The kind of understanding that our moms, you know, most of us at least, our moms gave to us when we were kids. You know, I mean, think about it. When you come running home to your mom and you've done something, you fell down and you hurt yourself, you had an accident at school, you didn't get picked for the team, you didn't get the part in the play you wanted, any and all of those kind of situations that we all run into. It's those kind of things that our mom is always like, you know, hey, it's going to be okay. And moms have a way of comforting us in the worst of our situations, in the times when, as children, you know, we're like, oh, you know, it's never going to be the same again. My life is over. And mom has a way of coming in and really speaking to us in a way that makes it all okay again. And that ultimately, without getting any kind of deep spiritual, biblical, any kind of thing like that, the truth of the matter is that more than anything else, that's grace. So when we grow up and we become adults, we no longer have that person, especially not permanently in our lives. It's not that our moms, you know, won't still be in our corner and cheer for us and stuff like that, but you know, most of us would agree that if you come running home to your mom when something bad happens to you, it would be, you know, not a great thing. And so we need to understand that we still, more than anybody else in our lives, we need to apply grace to ourselves. We need to cut ourselves some slack. Now, today we're going to be talking about phenomenal successes, about having an idea blow up and become more than you could have ever imagined it to be. But we're also going to take you through a journey where we're going to talk about the fact that on the road from startup to success, from here to there, there's some bumps in the road. And when you make those mistakes, those are okay. It's gonna be all right. And I want to be that voice. If you don't have that voice in your own head, if you don't have that person in your life, I want to be that voice right now to call out to you and to say to you, it's okay. And then I'm going to challenge you. Do you have the ability to give yourself enough grace to move on? Mistakes have happened. Maybe a split second before you turned this particular program on, maybe you did something and you wished you wouldn't have. I'm here to tell you that no matter how big or how small it feels like to you, it's okay. I am going to stand for you until you can stand for yourself to let you know it's okay. There is grace. Every one of us has failed, and every one of us will fail again. But in those failures comes the most amazing, beautiful things that happen in all of our lives. I saw a poster just the other day, and I think it sums this up just the best. When the caterpillar was convinced that it had reached the end of its life, the best that it possibly was ever going to be, it emerged as a butterfly. And that's what I want you to really think of today, is that thing that you are holding on to, that thing that you're beating yourself up over. I want you to let it go today, and then I want you to crack out of that cocoon and really let those wings spread so that you can be that amazing butterfly that I know that you are. Now, by now, some of you are wondering, I wonder what the heck he's going to talk about. And it's fun for me because this particular episode really caught me off guard. My guest today, Heather Stouffer from Mom Made Foods, you know, just really got real with me and talked to me about not only the great successes she's had in the last decade of her business, but also some of the mistakes that she made. And from that, I want to put together a show here for you today so that you can know that you are a phenomenal success. You can know it before it ever happens. You don't have to change a thing because yesterday is a canceled check. Tomorrow is a promissory note, meaning that it's got great things and potential for it, but today is the only legal tender that we have to spend. And so we want to encourage you. Your past does not equal your future. You are ready to shine and be massively successful in everything that you do. I hope that you will listen intently and catch that message as we speak to you today. Join me in welcoming Heather Stouffer. Hi, Heather. How are you today?
I'm good. Thanks for having me, Steve.
So, Heather, tell us a little bit about your journey, you know, to discover Mom Made Foods and what really got you to this place.
Well, I launched the company 10 years ago. It's hard to believe we're 10 years old this year. And it has been just that. It's been quite a journey. I launched it at a local farmer's market. We're based outside of Washington, D.C., in Alexandria, Virginia. As a mom, as a working mom who cares a lot about the food that I feed to my kids, I couldn't find anything that I felt good about feeding them when I needed something quick and easy, and everything at that time was loaded with preservatives and food coloring and, you know, didn't have organic ingredients and so on. So I launched Mom Made as a brand to be quick, easy, and very healthy foods, meals, and snacks geared towards kids. And now, fast forward 10 years later, we're in retailers nationally, thousands of retailers, and all of our products are frozen, and we've got about a dozen different frozen meals and snacks that are organic and antibiotic-free meats and low sodium and made so the kids love them.
Is there any special trick you have in there to make it so that the kids actually like them?
A whole lot of research and development work, Steve. Yeah, I mean, it's tricky. Kids have, you know, different tastes and palates than adults do, and perception is everything. You know, if it's not just the right size or the right texture, then it might not even go in the mouth, and it has nothing to do with taste. So through the years, we've really learned so much about kids and their food preferences, and how to get the product so that they're really customized for kids and what kids like. So we make things, for example, in our spaghetti, we make the noodles are already cut, the 3-inch organic spaghetti noodles. And the meatballs are bite-sized. So that it's fun for a kid to just dig into. And obviously once they put it in their mouth, they need to like the taste too. But we spend a lot of time and energy working on making sure that the products are really accessible and a fun experience for the child to eat.
Yeah. You got a tough market, you know, because kids are so much fun to try to put food in front of them that they will both eat as well as, you know, has any nutritional value for them.
Right, exactly. Yeah, and, you know, I think so many of us just live such busy lives, and then food takes a back seat in terms of importance and during a busy day. And particularly for kids, our philosophy is just because, you know, mom or dad is running the kids around to their activities and doesn't have time to cook dinner, or mom or dad is coming home from work late and running late and doesn't have time to cook dinner, that just because we're really busy doesn't mean we sacrifice nutrition, particularly for our kids. As an adult, you can make that choice for yourself, but for a child, you know, nutrition is just so important. They don't eat very much, and so everything, a large majority of what they eat needs to be really good fuel for their bodies.
Absolutely, yeah. I remember when my wife and I came to the realization that the category of food that we used to call kid food was probably better called junk.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know. So much of it is. And there's no reason for it, but, you know, 1 in 3 kids right now is obese in America, and there's a huge problem. So we're doing what we can to clean up food, and fortunately we're starting to see other manufacturers and even restaurants start to clean up their menus and their products.
Mm, nice. So after 10 years of being in business, what is the number one thing that you've really learned about being a successful woman in business?
The one thing, gosh, that's a tough one, Steve. I've learned a lot. I learn something every day. I always tell my husband that it's like, it's not, you know, live and learn. It's learn and live, because I'm always learning. And every day there's, you know, a new lesson. And no year gets easier, I don't think, as, you know, as the business goes on. I think, if anything, the hurdles and obstacles just come faster, and they're more expensive mistakes to make and so on. But I guess at the end of the day, the one thing that that I remind myself and my team regularly is that it's okay to make mistakes. But what it's not okay to do is not recognize that it was a mistake and figure out how to fix it so that it doesn't happen again. But if you're not making mistakes, then you're not taking risks, and you're not moving as quickly as you could or possibly should be. But it's all about the, you know, recovering quickly and figuring out how to overcome it so that it doesn't happen again, and turning it into an opportunity. And I'm an internal optimist, and I don't think we'd be even having this conversation if I wasn't, because it's really taking every situation and saying, okay, what's the positive that we can learn from this? Because it's just so easy. There's so many obstacles in starting a business and growing a business and sustaining a business through, you know, business growth and economic times and cash flow issues and all those things that, you know, if you don't just keep a positive outlook, then it just doesn't work.
And Heather has a phenomenal company. It's not like her company isn't succeeding because of those issues that she's ran into. In fact, it's probably more so succeeding because she's had issues that she's had to overcome. Every time that we stretch ourselves, we grow a little bit, and it gives us the opportunity to do know, more know, and be better than what we were before. I hope you've gotten some great information already. We're going to continue right after this commercial break here on Thriving entrepreneur.
Never has there been a better time for women to hack success. The shift is on and the breakthroughs are real. We're taking success to a whole nother level. Join us at the Women's Success Summit, a gathering of dynamic, smart women helping women. We want to learn about you and what you have to offer. Bring your A game and be prepared to transact some business. Oh, and by all means, dress to impress.
Register at eWomenNetwork.com.
You've heard Kathy and I talk about it. You've seen the workshops. You have watched as others of your friends have become a best-selling author. And now it's your turn. Let me ask you this. What would being a best-selling author do for your business? Over 80% of people surveyed said that they want to write a book, which means that if you're listening, you probably are one of those people. Now is your time because you have a message that needs to be shared. That message is not for you. It's not for your ego. It is because it serves other people. Kathy and I are here to help you share your unique brilliance with the world. All you need to do is go to wehelpyouthrive.com, check us out, and find out how you can be a best-selling author today.
Welcome back to Thriving Entrepreneur.
This is Steve. I'm here with Heather Stouffer, and we are talking to you today about thriving through your mistakes. You see, it's not a matter of not making any mistakes. We fall so easily into that trap of perfectionism. We beat ourselves up. We're you know, our own worst enemy because we somehow buy into this message that says that if we're not perfect, then we're not good enough. And the truth couldn't be further from that. I hope that you heard some of the things that Heather has dealt with in her business. You know, she's had to learn how to really manage the money of her business. Not necessarily her home funds, although I know that there are those of you who that's, you know, one of the things you have to learn how to do. You know, not necessarily did she just wake up one day and have all of the skills that you need in order to be a successful entrepreneur. I want you to really let that soak in. I want you to really take to heart that you have something that the world needs, and you need to allow yourself the room to succeed through your failures. Do you hear what I'm saying? It's not a matter of succeeding without ever failing. It's not a matter of if I'm not perfect, I'm not okay. It really, truly is all about making mistakes and then turning that thing you tripped on into a stepping stone to the next higher level for your life, for your business. I know you can do it, and I believe in you. And like I said, I'm standing in the gap for you, giving you the grace to tell you that it's okay. You know, I mean, I think you've hit on a really big thing, especially, I think, more so than men in business, that women really struggle with. And that's the giving ourselves grace for our mistakes. Yeah, you know, I mean, can you talk in a little bit more detail about that? What do we need to do to make a mistake with grace, if you will?
Well, I think admitting that you made a mistake, whether it's to, you know, to the business, to the employee, to the customer, to, you know, whoever it is, that wherever the mistake occurred, to be honest and open about it, and then figure out, as I said, how to, you know, deal with it, but then make sure whatever process needs to be developed or, you know, maybe it was a supplier issue. So find another, you know, three suppliers so that, you know, that doesn't happen again. And just, you know, always figuring out, okay, so we did this, but how can we become stronger because of this?
I had a friend of mine that said one time, it isn't so much a matter of how much you make mistakes. It's more about how quickly can you get to the place where you can, you know, make a new decision and move on.
Mm-hmm. I totally agree. Yeah, the more you let it fester and, you know, be indecisive about it, the more, you know, the rest of everything else just goes to a standstill.
So do you think it is the kind of thing that there may be some tricks that a person could use to help themselves, you know, move out of that natural tendency to, you know, really want to live with that mistake and kind of let it go and move on?
Well, I don't think that mistakes are failure, and that's a perception thing for me. But I make sure to communicate that to everyone on my team, that I expect them to make mistakes. If they're not, then they're not pushing the envelope. And if they're not pushing the envelope, I don't want them on the team. So, you know, it's just important to make that clear and then to reinforce it. I also tell my kids that, that, you know, you can't helicopter parent and watch everything they do, and they're going to make mistakes, and that's A-okay. And that's just you know, you have to just continually tell yourself that and then, you know, role play it as well, you know, live it.
Right. Yeah, that's really good advice. In fact, I remember almost exactly this time last year, the gentleman I was interviewing, you know, he was talking about how in his construction company, he's actually found that by allowing your people to have a place where they can mess up, they then actually work harder for you and do more for you because they know that it's okay if they do.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah.
Well, I think that's really good insight. I mean, I think it's something that all of us as entrepreneurs really struggle with is, you know, beating ourselves up, you know, I don't think.
Right. Well, and we're never satisfied, right? We're always going for the next thing. And a lot of people say, you know, wow, I can't believe, you know, that you guys have come this far and you've done all this. And that's always just really nice to hear, but it's, I'm already thinking, you know, about what I've got in the next 12 months to achieve. So it's always, what's next, what's next, what's next? And I'll say that's one of my faults, is just taking time to really, you know, celebrate the milestones and on both a, you know, really at a personal level. But I'm always, you have to just keep thinking, keep planning, keep the momentum. And for me, in order to do that, I tend not to slow down and look back, which I probably should more of.
What kind of things do you do to help celebrate yourself? And where do you create the milestones? Do you do celebrations for just day-to-day things or monthly? Or what do you do that works for you?
For me or for the team?
Well, let's start with you personally first.
Well, as I said, I don't do much for me personally. For the team, though, I do, you know, I'm very aware of and also to our customers, just, you know, saying thank you or well done or, you know, when something goes right, pointing it out and really celebrating that. And that could be something small, like, you know, just a well-written email that's communicating something that's difficult, or it could be something big, like, you know, we're doing a rollout into 600 new stores, and the rollout, you know, we get the purchase order, and we get paid for the purchase order, and then we'll, you know, go out for lunch or, go out for a drink or something after work to celebrate.
Well, have you found that the more you incentivize your people, the harder they work for you? Or is there a certain place where you feel like, you know, I've done too much and they need to just work and not get so many rewards? Is there a breaking point for that?
I'm not sure that there is. I mean, I think people certainly want to work in a positive atmosphere, but you want to make sure that, you know, you're given the high fives and things like that for things that actually warrant it and not. But I think all of us are so busy and moving from one thing to another, a gazillion things on our desk in any one day, that it's just finding that moment or two per day to connect with each employee and make sure that you're recognizing some piece of work that, you know, that's gone well. I don't know that there's a too much factor necessarily, but maybe that's just my personal style. I'm not sure.
No, I'm not sure that there is a right or wrong answer for that. It's just always interesting to hear different people's insight into, how they reward their teams and what they do for themselves.
Yeah, and I think it's important, though, to have both, you know, the short-term, the daily recognition, or even just something like thank you, to then long-term with, you know, quarterly and annual goals and a clear bonus structure and so on. I think all that's important too, and everything works together.
So here's the thing. Some of you have large teams that you already work with. Others of you, you wake up every morning and the person that's going to go to work with you is you. You know, you're going to get dressed and go to an office, or, you know, maybe you're going to put on a really comfy pair of fuzzy slippers and you're going to pad down the hallway and you're going to work in your home office. Either one of those is amazingly great. The thing about it is that you want to begin now at whatever level you're at, creating the culture that you want your company to be. What kind of an environment do you really, really, really crave to work in? Think about that for a second. I mean, how do you like to be rewarded? So we start off by rewarding ourselves. If we practice doing it for ourselves, if we practice doing it with ourselves, we will then end up doing it for our crew. It's always so much easier to overlook our little rewards than it is to reward the people that work for us. So think about this. What is one goal today that you want to succeed at? It doesn't have to be big. I mean, it could be, I want to make one sales call today. I'm going to reach out to one person and I'm going to offer them my package. That's not too tough, is it? Maybe it's, I need to create that email that's going to then go out to my list. That one would be all right too. So either, you know, anything like that, and you know what you need to get done today. Pick one thing, okay? And then it doesn't matter whether it takes you 5 minutes to do it or it's a 5-hour assignment. Pick that one thing. And then I want you, before you start it, to also pick out, how am I going to reward myself for having reached that goal today? Okay, you got that in mind? You've got an idea what you're going to do nice for yourself? I mean, maybe it's a cup of coffee from Starbucks. Maybe you need to go for a walk out and enjoy the sunshine on your face. You know what makes you feel really great. You know, I mean, some of you, what you really need to do is you need to just get a whole bunch of those, Dollar Tree stock certificates of accomplishment. And you need to, after reaching a goal like that, you need to give yourself a certificate. Today, Steve, you know, got a radio show recorded. You know, that would be something I could do for myself. And I'm awarding myself the certificate. And then don't just, you know, like, you know, shove it in that pile of papers that's on your desk. Get yourself, again, like, even from the Dollar Tree, a little frame. Put that certificate in the frame and hang it on your wall right next to you. Does that got your mind going? Well, we're going to take a quick commercial, and then we're going to come right back here on Thriving Entrepreneur.
This is the EWN Radio Network.
Never has there been a better time for women to hack success. The shift is on, and the breakthroughs are real. We're taking success to a whole nother level. Join us at the Women's Success Summit, a gathering of dynamic, smart women helping women. We want to learn about you and what you have to offer. Bring your A game and be prepared to transact some business. Oh, and by all means, dress to impress.
Register at eWomenNetwork.com.
You've heard Kathy and I talk about it. You've seen the workshops. You have watched as others of your friends have become a best-selling author. And now it's your turn. Let me ask you this. What would being a best-selling author do for your business? Over 80% of people surveyed said that they want to write a book, which means that if you're listening, you probably are one of those people. Now is your time because you have a message that needs to be shared. That message is not for you. It's not for your ego. It is because it serves other people. Kathy and I are here to help you share your unique brilliance with the world. All you need to do is go to WeHelpYouThrive.com. Check us out and find out how you can be a best-selling author today.
Welcome back to Thriving Entrepreneur.
This is Steve, and I'm here with Heather Stouffer of Mom Made Foods. We are having a really fun discussion today, talking about the successes that we have in our life and how those come from moving through mistakes and to structure. And ultimately, that's really what we're looking for, is we're looking for ways to create structure in our life. So when we do make a mistake, when we do have something that doesn't turn out exactly the way that we need to, you know, we can use that as the perfect opportunity to then be able to create a system, to create a structure that is going to then make our company a better place to work and more successful because of the fact that we went through the thing that we went through. And the same is true with our successes. I mean, don't just learn from your mistakes. If it worked, repeat it. Do it again and again and again and again, because, you know, if it worked, maybe that's a secret on what the customers are looking for. You said earlier it's the 10th anniversary for your company. Looking back over the 10 years and all the successes and all the failures, if you knew 10 years ago what you know now, what would be some of the things you might find yourself changing or doing differently?
I probably wouldn't be in business. I think, though, that it's part of the naivete going into it that led me into figuring out all that I have through the years. I didn't know that it would be so difficult through the years to, you know, raise capital and sustain the growth. You know, growth is a great thing, but in our industry, you have to make the product before it ships, and you have to very often pay for the product before you get paid for it. And so cash flow and growth is so tricky to manage, and we've grown exponentially through the years. So that's been really, really complex, and fortunately we've been able to get through all of that. I mean, what would I change? Or I'm not sure I could say I'd do anything differently, but it was, you know, it's been a really tough road getting here, and but it's also very rewarding to. It's hard to believe it's been 10 years because it really doesn't seem. Seems like it's been a couple years. It seems like it's been sort of a blip, but now it's a huge chunk of my life and life's work. So it's pretty neat to look back and think, gosh, we've taken this from, you know, farmer's market to be major retailers in the U.S. And it's really been an awesome journey.
Are there some examples of some things you tried that didn't work out so well, and how you were able to adjust?
It's like which one, right? I'm trying to think of a specific example, and we've had. I think the main thing that we've had to do is just be flexible, Steve. We found, for example, in launching a new product, you know, you put all this work into research and development, then you have designer work on it, you know, and you work on the pre-production runs and approve those, and then you have to pre-sell it to get the distribution to warrant a print run of the packaging and so on, and then you send the label off for approval to our friends at, you know, the USDA, and they'll change a word, or they'll turn something around and say not approved, or they'll hold up the approval because they're changing their whole computer system, and so we're all of a sudden in a month-long delay of a product rollout while we're just waiting for a label approval and can't go to print until you have it. So those kinds of things have been there's just never enough time to build into a new product development cycle. You know, you think you've got it all mapped out and locked down, and it's just what we've learned is that you just have to be so flexible and so quick to, you know, communicate with the whole team, everybody involved, with what the status is, how do we overcome it? And, you know, if you get to the point of a new product rollout and then it's delayed a month with a major retailer and they've got, you know, resets happening that are scheduled and so on, it's really difficult to reschedule. So we've had things like that that are just really, really tricky because there's only so much you can do to move something through the cycle, but fortunately we've overcome them just by being open and keeping everybody, you know, as much in the loop as you can and giving everybody every bit of information you have. But I guess what I've learned in all of that is that you can't over communicate.
I love talking with business people because all of us as entrepreneurs, I think we tend to get so laser focused on our own little world, you know, whether it be a solo entrepreneur that's working from their home or somebody that has several employees, you know, that when we get a chance to hear somebody else say, you know, I had this struggle with this company, or, you know, I did this thing and I thought it was great and then it got denied and sent back to me and I had to redo it all over. You know, those are the times when we can stop and breathe and go, hey, you know what? I'm not the only person that's had some struggles and some mistakes and some trial and error and those kind of things and still made it forward.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, well, and we've had some products that have not worked, you know, and you just have to recognize it. Even there's a product that we loved, and sorry, I have two kids, and it's my son's favorite product. And you know, the market it didn't sell, and we had it in a lot of different retailers, and taste great, tests well, kids love it, but it doesn't sell. So, you know, you have to always look at the numbers too, and I think that's one thing. It probably took me a few years to learn is that the numbers talk, and you got to really listen to the numbers, particularly on specific items and sales. I could never predict the product rating, product sales rating of the way our products are ranked and how they sell. We try to predict, and that's always a big joke in the office, but ultimately it has to go to market before, and then you let the consumers tell you. It could be the best product on earth, but it might not sell. So that's also been very interesting, and I used to think in my earlier days that, we'll just pour more time and energy into marketing this, and that maybe it's this or maybe it's that, but it's like, no, actually, if you've done the same amount of marketing on everything else in that retailer and this one particular item's selling half of what the other ones are, then you've got a doozy of an item and you got to take care of it.
So do you still have the company make that particular product for your children so that they can still have it?
Oh, my kids would dream of that. Yeah, no, that's, and each product is kind of like a child in a way. And, it takes so much time and effort to concept it and launch it, design it, and then take it to market. But, it's hard to say, okay, this isn't working. But it's also really important to admit that and then move on.
Ooh, that's so good. Admit that and then move on. If there's nothing else, if you don't normally take notes when you listen to this, even if you're driving down in the car, I'm not saying, crash into somebody and write something down, but make a mental note, make an actual written note on it, type it down on your computer somewhere. Admit it, and then move on. And that's really all we need to do. That's how we begin to apply grace to our own lives, is by simply taking an honest evaluation of what has happened, admit what succeeded, what failed, what we'd like to change, learn from it, but most importantly, then move on. So I know some of you are at a place today where you need to go ahead and give yourself permission to move on. And I want to again stand for you to be able to step away from the past and move on. We're going to take another quick commercial break, and then we will be right back here on Thriving Entrepreneur. You've heard Kathy and I talk about it. You've seen the workshops. You have watched as others of your friends have become a best-selling author. And now it's your turn. Let me ask you this. What would being a best-selling author do for your business? Over 80% of people surveyed said that they want to write a book, which means that if you're listening, you probably are one of those people. Now is your time, because you have a message that needs to be shared. That message is not for you. It's not for your ego. It is because it serves other people. Kathy and I are here to help you share your unique brilliance with the world. All you need to do is go to wehelpyouthrive.com, check us out, and find out how you can be a best-selling author today.
Welcome back to Thriving Entrepreneur.
So I know that we've got a lot of the listeners that are moms, and they would be interesting in finding out, first of all, what makes mom-made foods different, and how can that help my kids? And then secondly, where can I get them? So where could a person find out more information about your product?
So our website, Steve, is the best place to go, mommadefoods.com. and folks can enter in their zip code, and they'll see all the stores near them. And if we're not in a store near them, we are available on Amazon as well. And what makes Mom Made unique? We freeze everything, so freezing's our preservative. And all of our meals and snacks are really kid favorite recipes, and then we pack them with nutrition and make them as healthy as we can. So we've got a line of antibiotic-free, low-sodium meatballs that are delicious and just an easy protein, something different than a hot dog or a chicken nugget. They also make a great appetizer for any of your listeners who don't have kids. They're, you know, heat them up in 2 minutes, and you can take them to a party with a side of whatever your favorite dipping sauce is, and they're delicious. And then we've got a line of meals, and the meals are, for example, our mac and cheese has sweet potato and butternut squash puree in it and whole peas, and it's 100% organic. And so it's, you know, it's mac and cheese, but it's got peas and two other vegetables in it. And it's also 5 times less calories and sodium than a boxed mac and cheese, which is really hard to believe. But it's true. So we're using organic ingredients and taking out, in the mac and cheese, for example, we use the sweet potato and the butternut squash help turn the product a really, you know, bright yellowy orange, which is a very familiar color to kids. But we're doing that with the purees and not with artificial coloring.
So that is mommadefoods.com, mommadefoods.com. And I would encourage people to check it out and see if that might be a really good solution for your kids. I know all of us as parents, especially when they were little, you know, we all struggle with, you know, how can I feed this kid and how can I do
right.
it in a way that doesn't make me feel like a horrible parent while I'm doing it.
Right. Yeah, no, that's where we do feel horrible, right? And we don't need any more guilt. So that's one of the nice side benefits of what we do is, you know, give parents something less to feel guilty about and something that their kids still will love and eat.
So I really appreciate you taking the time. Before I let you go, I mean, I know that there's probably been some real light bulbs for some of the ladies that are listening, well, or even guys that are listening, about the mistakes we make and the ways that we can still thrive in business. What would be one or two pieces of advice that you could give to aspiring entrepreneurs who are just getting ready to start their journey into their new business?
Two things. One, Steve, is that the idea, I talk to so many entrepreneurs regularly who are like, well, you know, I'm going to start a business, but I can't tell you what it is. The idea is like 0.005% of what it takes to be an entrepreneur, and the execution is the remaining 99.995%. And so my point is, don't be afraid to talk to people about your idea. Everybody's going to have input and thoughts and ideas that will help you further formulate, you know, what your business is or could potentially be. Everyone, regardless of what their role is in society or, you know, even for me, whether I'm talking to a 5-year-old or if I'm talking to a 90-year-old, whether they're in the industry or not in the industry, all of these people are going to have some input into my idea that is really valuable. And collectively, if you're open to listening to it, it can be really instrumental. So don't be afraid to share your idea is point number one. And point number two is pick up the phone and call everyone and keep calling until you get an answer. You know, I was not in the food industry before I started Mom Made, and people say, well, how did you know where to buy the food bowls and the packaging and the ingredients, and you know, how'd you get into your first retailer? I called all of them, and I studied. You know, I looked around in the grocery store, and I would buy things that looked like they might be the same shape or size of something that I wanted. And then I'd look on the bottom of that bowl or cup or whatever it was. And then I'd Google that company and I'd call that company and I'd say, I'm hoping that you can help me. You know, I'm looking to buy a bowl similar to the bowl that, you know, XYZ that I just bought in the grocery store. And that's, you know, Google, I can't imagine starting a business without Google, but it's also important to just not be afraid to pick up the phone and call. And if that person doesn't have an answer, then ask them, do they know anybody who might have an answer? And people love to give advice. And there's a lot of free advice available too for entrepreneurs. Your show is wonderful. But there's, you know, there's so many free resources with the Small Business Development Centers, with the SCORE, the retired executives, who it's all free advice that is just so helpful. So seek advice and don't be afraid to ask for advice.
And that's great advice, too. This is Heather Stouffer. She's the CEO of Mom Made Foods. They're celebrating their 10-year anniversary. I really do encourage you to check it out at mommadefoods.com. Thanks, Heather. I really appreciate you taking the time with us today.
Thank you so much, Steve, for having me.
I am so glad every time we get an opportunity to have a successful entrepreneur on the show. Every single one of them brings their unique brilliance right here to you so that you can learn something from them. And I hope that you really were able to hear Heather's heart. You know, I mean, it's so cool for me because she's been in business for 10 years. She's done phenomenally well. You know, her product is, you know, literally on shelves of stores that you probably go into every day. And yet she was willing to sit down with us and be honest and say, hey, you know, I'm a human being. I've made mistakes. I've had phenomenal successes. And what I do from every single one of them is I learn and I grow and I get better. And I love that advice she gave to us at the end. Always, always, always be willing to ask for and seek out advice. There's always going to be somebody that's, you know, 2 to 5 steps ahead of you. There's also going to be people that are 20, 50, you know, they're like the people you just dream of being like. But there's also people that are just, you know, they're only in just a couple of steps ahead of you. Maybe they went through last year in their business what you're going through this year in your business. Either of those levels, you know, you need to have those people in your life that are there to help you out. And you really need both of those groups. You need somebody who's just gotten past what you're currently going through, and you need somebody who can look back at the whole road and say, I know what it's like to be there, but I've come through it. I've come through it maybe many, many times, and I'm ready to move on to the next step. And here's how I can show you how to do that too. Advice, mentors, coaches in our lives are so hugely impactful and majorly empowering to what we do. So I really hope that you will take that to heart and really, truly, you know, look for advice, seek out advice, and then really take the advice that you get to heart. And also, as I've been, dare I say, harping on all episode long, today's your day to give you grace. Doesn't matter what's happened. Doesn't matter how many times or how well you've beaten yourself up over that thing. Now you can let it go. Now you can be, like I said at the beginning of the show, like the mother would do to their child. You can wrap your own arms around yourself, and you can make that thing that seems impossible, that seems like it's the end of your world, or is insurmountable to overcome. You can give yourself the grace to move from where you are to that wonderful, beautiful, excellent future that is right there in front of you. I want to remind you today, remember, you are uniquely brilliant. There's nobody else out there like you. You were created for a purpose. You are as uniquely special as every snowflake that is different. The world needs you. There are people, I promise you, right now, that are on, you know, Google or some other type of search engine, and they're looking for the solution to the thing that you do with grace and ease every day. And I encourage you, share that with the world. Share your message. And always know that Kathy and I are here to help you to live every day of your life and experience in every moment of your business what it feels like to be a thriving entrepreneur. Until next time, have a great week.
Thanks for listening to Thriving Entrepreneur today. If you want to get your question answered, send an email to questions@wehelpyouthrive.com. We look forward to you joining us again next time.
You've heard Kathy and I talk about it. You've seen the workshops. You have watched as others of your friends have become a best-selling author. And now it's your turn. Let me ask you this. What would being a best-selling author do for your business? Over 80% of people surveyed said that they want to write a book, which means that if you're listening, you probably are one of those people. Now is your time because you have a message that needs to be shared. That message is not for you. It's not for your ego. It is because it serves other people. Kathy and I are here to help you share your unique brilliance with the world. All you need to do is go to wehelpyouthrive.com, check us out, and find out how you can be a best-selling author today.